Hi, Jesse. I'm a bit peeved this morning because I'm having to use the webcam on my Mac rather than the one I plug in via USB because it seems to have packed it in and is dead as a doornail. It's not pining for the fjords. It's not resting, it's dead. So, you won't get as clear a picture of me as usual, so that's disappointing. But, well, it was a dull old morning here. Beat Bark Moz, nice to see you again. You'll enjoy. Well, that's an interesting question, Jesse. It depends what you mean by bassoon. He'll be able to show us the various versions of bassoon he plays. He plays versions of the bassoon that go back to the time that the bassoon wasn't the bassoon, it was the dulcian. Barkhoven Rahms. Yeah, I'm messing with you, Jesse. He does. he plays a Baroque bassoon, and its ancestor, the dulcian. Jesse, did you see it in regards to hi Zazu? Did you see it in regards to his work as a law lecturer as well? Well, tutor, law lecturer, something like that. He's a very smart cookie. He's a very nice man, and has been enormously helpful to me in getting into the early music scene here in Brisbane. Oh, okay. Today's program, I have a special guest, Sean Wigley, who I've been playing with for a while and still playing with, and we're just having a chat. We're just going to have a chat about our experiences playing Baroque music together and now Renaissance music together, his story, because he has quite an interesting story, it's just gonna be a chat and a little bit of Baroque music and a little bit of Renaissance music with some interesting instruments. And actually, I'm looking forward to the next program. I'm going to do it on Die Stille Liebe. Oh, right. No, that'd be an early education specialist. No, he teaches, 19-year-olds. Okay, so it's the top of the hour. 10 a.m. here in Brisbane. Hello, Eric. In Brisbane, Australia. It's Saturday morning. My name is Cathy Williams de Vries. Today's program, I'll be chatting with my friend and colleague, Sean Wigley. So let's give him a call. Sean.
Hello. Hi.
Hi. Welcome to the gang. Everyone, this is Sean Wigley.
Hello, everyone.
We've known each other for quite a while, haven't we? It's been a few years since I encountered you at an early music concert, and
That might have been about 5 years ago.
although
Yeah.
actually you knew me
I knew who
before.
you were, but I hadn't had the chance to meet you.
Well, actually, you saw me play.
That's what I'm saying, in 1999. So I actually saw you play. What was that competition called again? It was Young
Young
Performers, wasn't
Performers, yeah.
it?
Yeah,
I heard you play on that occasion, but I hadn't actually met you in person. Yeah.
As well as being an early music specialist, which is kind of your thing on the side, you teach law at Griffith Uni.
I teach law courses at Griffith University, Griffith with a G, Griffith University in Brisbane. So that's what I do for a living.
Yeah.
But I play music on the side.
Well, actually, your musical interest on the side keeps you quite poor, doesn't
It does keep me quite poor.
it? Do you want to tell the gang? Everyone's saying, "Hey, Sean! Hey, Sean! Hey, Sean! Happy to have you joining Kathy as a guest."
Hello, everyone.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about you. You originally did a music degree,
I have got a music degree from the University of Queensland, yes.
but you decided to go in another direction
Yeah.
after.
I also did a law degree at UQ.
Yeah.
I just felt when I just got a little bit, I think, burned out by playing at the time. So I wanted to go into something different. So I decided to go into academia, which is something completely different. Having a break from practice, from playing, and doing something that involves you reading books and arguing legal arguments. So, yeah.
I did a law subject
Oh, did you? Okay.
when I was doing an accounting degree, because I thought, oh, I really need to get a real job.
Oh, like business law, is that right?
Yeah.
Yes, that can be a bit. That's quite a tricky course, isn't it? Did you find it quite tricky?
Well, I had no trouble recalling the cases. I've got sort of
Yeah.
a photographic memory in terms of, who argued what. But I was hopeless at the names.
Okay.
So I could tell you in great detail all about the case, but I couldn't tell you it was Smith versus Jones. Or
Yeah.
no, I think I got a five for it, I
Well,
think.
that's pretty good. Yeah.
I also love to read, although my general reading material extends to horror
Yeah.
and ghost books. Now, what got you into early music, and also tell us the wonderful story about what you did with an inheritance you got.
Okay, part of what I did, or how I got into early music, it's sort of a bit strange. I can't really recall how I actually got into it. I just think I listened to some really interesting recordings, and one of them I'm actually going to play a little bit later on today, by the English Concert, a group called the English Concert, Trevor Pinnock, who's the director of that group. And that got me very interested in the interesting instruments in particular and how they differ from modern instruments. But when I first started playing rock music, I think I didn't have access to early music, early instruments. And I was a little bit, I think perhaps a little bit shy in going into playing on early instruments. So I just played on modern instruments. So quite often I would play chamber music at the University of Queensland on Baroque instruments. Oh, sorry, on modern instruments, playing Baroque music. I tried on a few occasions, to start up a baroque group, and we did do some works on modern instruments. I think there was one concert where we played Bach's first Brandenburg Concerto with modern instruments, the first movement. But it was something that was very difficult to sustain long term, because at that time I don't think people were particularly interested in Baroque music to the same extent that they are today. So that kept on happening, having an interest in that area. And we had little chamber groups that I formed from time to time where we performed Baroque music. But in about 2015, early 2015, I was left with, I had a relative who had died who was quite interested in music. And they left me a large inheritance. And well, about the year before, I brought myself a Baroque bassoon. And the group that I was playing in was about to disband because quite a number of people were going overseas, and quite a lot of people were just far too busy. So what I did was I nominated myself to be president, and I got a large inheritance from a relative who died, and I spent a lot of that money on getting instruments. I think the first instruments I got were oboes. I got some flutes, I got some Baroque trumpets, I got some horns, okay, and a few other instruments. I've got a sackbut, I've got a number of dulcians, which are sort of Renaissance bassoons. Have I
You'll
missed
have to
anything?
tell them. You'll have to tell them what a sackbut is.
A sackbut, sorry, is a type of it's an early trombone, okay. But it's hammered as opposed to the brass being spun. So it's hammered with a hammer. So if you have a look at it looks very dinted, but that's just the way that it's made. So a lot of the money I spent, I also got a harpsichord as well. So a lot of the money was from that inheritance, but progressively I added instruments to the collection based upon my earnings, which aren't that great. But it's left me very, very poor. But we've had the opportunity, I think, in the first time in Brisbane, to have a full-size period instrument orchestra. Brisbane's the city that myself and Kathy live in. And I think the first concert that we had with Brisbane Baroque players with the full Baroque orchestra. I believe the first work that we played was a piece by Murray. Okay, a orchestral piece, a very famous fanfare by Murray. I think the second piece was actually a concerto with Kathy playing it. It was an arrangement. It was a version of the fourth Brandenburg concerto that was in F major, and it had a violin solo. Can you remember that, Kathy?
I remember playing it wasn't it the Bach Brandenburg Concerto, the very famous one.
It was number four, but it was
Is
arranged
that for the
for.
two recorders?
Yes, for the two recorders.
Yeah.
In a different key.
But
Is it?
no, yeah, so actually Bach rearranged that
Yes.
into a harpsichord
Yes, it
concerto
had a harpsichord part in there as
instead of the
well.
violin.
Yeah. So we played
So
that. And we also played an overture by Telemann as well. So we just keep on working. We've been doing that for the last 5 years. I stepped down as president at the end of last year. So I was president for about 4 years. I just wanted to focus a little bit more on playing. But I still have those instruments and I still collect them. And
You'll
I
have to
like.
get out a few, get out a few if you don't already have them out.
Oh, yeah, I'll get one out in a minute. I've got one just over there. But yeah, what I do is I lend them to students and other members of the community to play in our group. So I'll be just back in a moment. I'm just going to get a oboe d'amore that I purchased. I'll explain that in a moment. So an oboe, I have ordinary Baroque oboes, which are treble oboes, which are a little bit smaller, but I also have what's called a oboe d'amore. And Johann Sebastian Bach, who many of you would be familiar with, he wrote quite a lot for oboes and oboe d'amores. in particular Oboe de Morais, it was one of his favourites. He has written more oboe solos than for any other instrument in his orchestral and choral works. So even more than the violin, so it's a favourite of his.
Died out.
Yeah, it died out in the late, this is the Oboe de Morais, so it sort of died out about in the 1760s.
Mm.
So it was invented in the 1720s, and it died out in about the 1760s, okay, the early classical period. In fact,
you might want to just aim your phone down a bit so we can look at that.
Yeah, so I'm sorry, I'm just trying to show you the length of the instrument. So
it's quite long, isn't it? Yeah.
It's a little bit longer than an ordinary Baroque oboe, but has an unusual...
Almost looks like a coronglé bell, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's a bit like a small coronglé, but it's smaller than a coronglé. Coronglé is more related to the oboe de caccia, which is a longer instrument still from the Baroque period.
Mm, and that's the oboe de caccia is curved, isn't it?
Yeah, it's curved, yeah. So the oboe de caccia is bigger than this, but it has a horn-like bell, and it's bent to make it more easy to play.
Yeah.
And because they use steam and they bend the wood under steam and then cover it with leather. Okay. But with this oboe de Morais, it looks a lot like an ordinary Baroque oboe, except it's got this bell on the end, a tulipy bell, because the Baroque oboe has sort of a flamed, the treble bell has, Baroque oboe has a flamed bell, whereas this is a tulip bell. So there's a little bit of a chamber in here, and you have to make sure you always clean it out after you're playing it, water can accumulate. But some bassoons actually, often the Baroque period, actually have a chamber at the bottom as well, in the bell. Mm. So a few of the makers from the time actually had a tulip. That's the main thing. And it's also a little lower than only just a few notes lower than the Baroque oboe. So it's in the key of A. Okay? So it's two notes lower than a treble Baroque oboe, and it has a more darker sort of mellowy sort of sound.
I think instruments in A tend to be like that. I know that the A clarinet,
the gay clarinet, you find is the same thing.
Yeah,
it's yeah. Oh,
yeah. I don't know about you. I mean, I've told the gang that the reason I got into Baroque music and period instruments, and this doesn't just apply to Baroque period instruments because I have a classical period clarinet.
Oh, really? Yes.
Yeah. Is that by playing on these period instruments, I feel closer to the music and closer to the composer's intention. Yeah.
Yes, because they have a certain colour and a certain way that they respond. And I actually think that they're not any less instrument. You can potentially do just as well, if not better, a historical instrument than a modern instrument. It just takes longer. Yeah. And you have to be a little bit more careful. Yeah. So it does take an awful lot of time to prepare music on a Baroque instrument because you don't have keys. It's a much fatter, wider sound. And it just takes, I think you have to spend a lot more time practicing.
Oh, yeah.
And building up your strength. Whereas with a modern instrument, the instrument sort of is more automated.
Yeah.
But I actually prefer the sound. Once you do get it right, I prefer the sound of historical instruments.
And also, the pitch of sort of 415. Although I note that you have a couple of 392 instruments as well.
I do have a few 392 instruments as well, but I haven't had the chance to really play them all that much. But yeah, they're a little bit lower still.
I just adore my 392 alto recorder. It's just got the warmest sound possible. Okay, yeah. So we've natted enough. So I'm going to play a couple of pieces which were that we've done together.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the hang on. No.
Was it the Vivaldi, the A minor? Is that?
Yeah, that's right. Although it was interesting because I wasn't sort of the recorder player I am now, so I kind of panicked a little bit. I noted when I took the re when I listened to the recording that the reason I struggled so much was because the harder the music got, everybody sped up.
We did a little bit,
Oh,
yeah.
like a little
You live and learn.
bit,
Yep.
my God. And then the other piece is the Telemann double concerto for recorder and bassoon that we played with Madge as well. So I'll be playing those two pieces, then I'll come back to you. I'm gonna hang up now so that hang up with you now so that you can play the tracks, and I'll give you another call in about 10 or 15 minutes.
And that's for the pieces, yeah, that I'll be presenting. Yeah, I was talking
That's
about.
the pieces you've chosen. Yeah.
Yeah,
And
absolutely.
you'll probably be getting your Dulcian out, I suppose.
Sorry, you're.
Your Dulcian?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite hear
Oh,
that.
your Dulcian.
Oh, Dulcian. Do you want me to get that?
Oh, they'll want to see that. Oh, yeah, because that's
Okay, I'll get that now and I'll be back when you call, I should be ready.
All
Okay,
right,
thank
see you in a
you.
bit.
Yes.
Okay, so here we go. First couple of tracks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Seems such a unlikely combination to write for, recorder and bassoon. Okay, I'm just going to give Sean another call. Hello again.
Hi.
I was going to ask, because I found this when I started playing classical clarinet, is that the wood of Baroque instruments is a lot lighter, isn't it? And
generally speaking, yeah, it's made out of boxwood. Yeah, the oboes are made out of boxwood, for example, whereas these days they're made out of grenadilla or ebony, so yeah.
So do you find, as I found, that the expressive capabilities of instruments in the lighter woods are greatly enhanced?
Yes.
Because of the lighter wood.
Yes, that's
great. You can just sing through it, you know, and I think so.
Yeah.
I think whereas with the grenadilla, sometimes that gets in the road.
Yeah, it sometimes does, yeah.
Yeah, and especially with the recorders, they come in so many different woods, and all the different woods, you know, you've got maple and pear wood and boxwood, and and you do have the grenadilla if you want to play on the 20th century recorders
also,
as well.
The dimensions of the wood are different as well, the actual shape of the ball.
So especially with Renaissance instruments,
yeah.
I showed the gang when I introduced them to my Renaissance collection, and the bore is just huge inside the Renaissance instruments.
And because of that as well, I think you have a lot better expressive qualities. I just find that modern instruments, they just sound a lot more colder, I think.
Mm.
They're designed to be played easily, easily, rather than be just more expressive.
Mm.
Yeah, so that's the compromise, I think.
Yeah. We're not just interested in Baroque music. We like to go even further back, don't we?
Yes, sometimes we like to play music from the Renaissance. One of the groups that I've recently formed, called the Monteverdi Ensemble, with Kathy and a few others. So the Brisbane Monteverdi Ensemble. And we play on instruments that are from the 1600s. And late 1500s.
I can't wait to meet the sackbut player.
Yeah.
But we have a cornetto,
yes.
Which is not an ice cream.
So cornetto is a wooden. It's part of the brass family, but it's made of wood,
and it's got finger holes.
And it's got finger holes, so it's a bit like. So cornetto is because it's not because it's an ice cream.
Yeah.
Because it's shaped like a horn.
Yeah.
And it's got a trumpet-like mouthpiece, and it's carved wood. You play through a trumpet-like mouthpiece, and you can play chromatically on it. I think it's got a range of about 2 octaves.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. So do you want to introduce the couple of pieces that you've chosen?
Yeah. Okay, so the first piece that I've chosen is a sonata in 4 parts by Cima. So Cima. He was a composer active in Milan during the late 16th and early 17th centuries. So this was one of the pieces that really made me interested in works that form the transition between the Renaissance and the Baroque.
Because there's never, with music, it's never composers saying, okay, I'm going to stop writing Renaissance music and start writing Baroque music. It's this gradual evolution.
Yes.
And that continues through the entire musical history.
Yes.
You know, sort of Baroque music just didn't stop, you know, in 1750 when Bach. In fact, J.S. Bach was kind of a hanger-on, wasn't he, in terms of staying in the Baroque style?
Yes,
when
I think
composers were already moving into classical writing, you know, even before J.S. Bach.
From about the 1730s, you know, composed like Husserl, for example.
Yeah. It's just Just I find I sort of wonder why people don't believe in the theory of evolution, and yet in all aspects of human society and art and everything, it's just so evident. And what was the other piece that
So that
you
was by
wanted?
Chima. I was also going to play a piece from the late 1600s, which is sort of not the high Baroque, but sort of the mid Baroque period, by Matthias Weckmann. Okay, so this was a cycle of works for what we call a collegium, which is a group of student musicians. And they're written for cornetino, which is a small cornetto that I spoke about before. Sackbut, a bit like a trombone, violin, dulcian. I have a dulcian
Yes,
here.
we must. You must show us your
Yes, so this is a
dulcian.
bass dulcian, and that's one of the instruments that those pieces are written for. Okay, which is a bit like a bassoon, but it's in a single piece of wood.
Do you want to step back a little bit and play us
I
a
can,
few
yeah, sorry, it's a
notes?
bit hard for me to. I might just rearrange the room slightly. I'm sorry about the glare from the light, everyone. But this is a dulcian, okay? Is that okay? Better?
It's all right.
Sorry about that. We just have a bit of light coming in the window. So these are pieces, group of works, sonatas for the Collegium Musicum in Hamburg. They're written in the late 1600s. One of the instruments that's showcased is another instrument called the bombardo. Okay, so that's a bit like a bass shawm. And it's unusual because this was in the late 1600s, and by that stage, the shawm family was starting to become obsolete. So this instrument has a very direct sound.
It's a early oboe, isn't it?
It's before the oboe.
Yeah.
But before, there was the dulcian, which was like a compact bass shawm, but there was also the bass shawm itself. You had to actually stand up to play it.
So what type of wood is your dulcian made of?
It's made from maple.
Maple.
But usually the shawm bass instruments are made from boxwood.
So I find that the shawm an interesting instrument because I went to Shakespeare's Globe quite a lot when I was in London, and of course all the music accompanying that was the Shakespearean instruments, and it's a fascinating instrument because well you played it in your house when I was over there a while back, and it's powerful. Oh wow, it must have frightened the bogan neighbors of yours. Sean lives north of Brisbane. I don't actually think it's in the city of Brisbane. It's more the shire of
It's sort of in the commuter belt of Brisbane.
and
It's one of the outer-lying satellite cities.
Fuller. And the further you get from the inner city there, the more
The
bogans
more hick they get, yeah.
you And actually, because I think you said you only had an hour,
Yes.
did you want to, talk about the fash as well?
Yes, so this is a recording of the concerto in D major for two horns, two oboes, two bassoons, strings and continuo by a composer called Fasch, Fasch, Johann Friedrich Fasch. And it was off that CD that I became very inspired by the English concert with Trevor Pinnock. And this is one of the pieces that actually inspired me to form a Baroque orchestra eventually. It took about 16 years for it to happen. And it finally happened with the assistance of Kathy and a few other people, who kindly also made their instruments available to others as well. That's the concerto in D major. Okay, so that's the third piece by Fasch.
We played a Fash piece
Yes,
together
we have. There's
on
another D major one.
Yeah, was that a big orchestral piece? With
That
like
one's
horns and stuff,
other
or?
teacher, but it had flutes in it instead of horns.
Oh right,
Yes.
yeah. And what's I find interesting about Baroque music, and I learnt so much when Madge was over here from France, is that no two performances of a Baroque piece or even a Renaissance piece are the same because of you were expected to ornament and improvise. And so I mean, even your own performance of a piece, you'll never perform a Baroque piece the same way twice because composers of the day saw their scratchings on the paper more as just a suggestion. And it's like, go nuts. I remember listening to some Handel flute sonatas, and I was sort of only just, in my early into my journey in Baroque music, and I listened to the recordings, and I'm going, that doesn't look like the music I bought, because they're just all over the top, and it's so I could play 10 different recordings of the pieces that I've played now, just before, and each one would be completely different, and that's the fascinating thing with early music, because modern music now, everything's notated to within a
In a very
millisecond,
verbatim way.
and and also sort of pitches, microtones, and what's also interesting is the tuning system of the Baroque period, because especially when you're tuning your harpsichord. Because and I remember, was it Peter Ellis? He kept having to retune the harpsichord for each particular key we were playing in, because see, the modern piano is a complete cop out, isn't it? It's just what do they call it? Equal temperament, and it's a complete cop out because the major third and the minor third, if you use just intonation, the major third is actually wider than it is on a piano,
And it's more
in terms
resonant.
of sense different, and the minor th you know and so if you're using just intonation, an E sharp is not the same as an F, but you lose that on modern piano, and so sort of composers had to be careful, sort of what key they've written things in, and harpsichords had to be retuned so that you got the thirds right, and there's a tuning system called Velotti. Do you guys use that?
Yes, that's the one that we mostly use, yes.
Yeah,
And that has,
and that has certain
intervals that are nice and open.
Yeah,
So
it's
you don't get that with equal temperament because it's sort of a compromise, so to speak, just to make
yeah.
sure it fits in nicely into an octave,
Yeah.
but it and plays in different keys the same,
And
but doesn't.
I love how composers write so that you get a buzzing in your head. And if you're correctly in tune, you can actually hear like a fundamental tone that sort of fills out the chord, even though only two people are playing, you can hear three notes, and it's a fantastic effect. Okay, I'll let you go because you're a busy lad. You've got a concert coming
So you're
up.
going to play these pieces now?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yep, playing those pieces now, and then I'll come back and chat with the folks about a couple of pieces that I've chosen,
All
which
right.
feature clarinet and bassoon, so considerably later than your choices. But yeah,
Okay.
Shawnee has a life and a job, and yeah, and you've got a concert. I think it's very,
Tomorrow.
very brave. Tomorrow, is it? Wow. What are you
Yeah.
playing?
I'm playing some Telemann.
Nice, nice. Okay, well, does anyone have any questions for Sean before I let him go? And he does some practice for his concert tomorrow. Anyone got a question? It takes because the live stream is on delay. It just takes a little bit. No, we got to, well, I see 8 people tuned in. All right.
Hey.
It's been lovely to have you on.
Thank you, no problem at
And
all.
yeah, if oh, okay. How
You
long
have a
does it?
question?
Yeah, how long does it take to tune a harpsichord in between pieces?
I think he probably does it in about 5 minutes, but
Yeah.
usually, when I'm actually tuning the harpsichord for the first time in a day, it takes about 20 minutes. Yeah. Do it well.
Yeah. All right.
Right.
I'll let you go and practice and prepare for classes and stuff.
Okay.
And
Thanks so much, everyone.
yeah, so everyone, say goodbye to Shawnee.
Okay, have a
Okay,
good weekend.
best of luck tomorrow.
All right, thanks so
Okay,
much.
see ya. Bye bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, so yeah, it. I mean, if you know what you're doing, harpsichord tuning doesn't take all that long. All right, so let's hear some Renaissance and Baroque music on some interesting instruments.
Thank you. Thank you.
We come to a piece that Sean and I have played together, although there are two versions of it. Everyone knows the Bach Brandenburg 4, Concerto number 4, for two recorders and violin in G. And there is some conjecture, actually, that it may have actually been written for alto recorders in the key of G, which would make the the actual fingerings in the key of F, which is a lot easier on recorder, because the version in the key of G is quite tricky and has some notes that don't actually exist on the alto recorder. A top F sharp actually doesn't exist on the alto recorder, and you can either do a fake fingering and you might see this in the recording, where the recorder player has to quickly muffle the bell on their knee in order to get this top F sharp. So I've actually played this version. There's another version which is in the key of F, but is a harpsichord concerto, and that's the one I played with Sean and a recorder player called Michael Yelland. Although I have also played with a very good recorder player. She's sort of the professional recorder player here in Brisbane, the one in G. And I have to say that playing the second recorder part in the Bach Brandenburg Fourth Concerto has the scariest introduction for a second recorder player in the history of music. It's terrifying, because you just start bop, 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 and you're going up to a top G, and so it was a scary experience, but it was a wonderful experience because the right person saw Yvette and I play the Brandenburg, and it just so happened that a couple of recorder parts came up in the Queensland Symphony Orchestra and Opera Queensland production of A Flowering Tree. And because the right person saw us play the Bach Brandenburg, we got the gig. It was my first and only professional gig as a recorder player, and it was a wonderful experience. Okay, so this is Bach Brandenburg Concerto number 4, and this is an amazing performance. Thank you. Oh, those wonderful days when you could kiss and hug people. Yeah, that's an absolutely incredible performance. They take it so fast. You know, as someone who has played that piece, I can tell you that's just amazing playing, especially from the violinist as well. Okay, so I was going to play a piece by Stamitz for clarinet and bassoon, but I realised it didn't have a lot of personal significance for me, other than it was a clarinet and bassoon piece. But I am going to play you a couple of pieces that do have some significance for me. So Sean and I have only played together in a period instrument capacity. But I have played with bassoonists on modern bassoon in the past. Now, I actually haven't played this piece, but I have seen it played, and the bassoonist is now a contrabassoon at the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra, one of the top orchestras in Australia, amazing player, Brock Emerson. And this is the Richard Strauss duet concertino for clarinet and orchestra, clarinet, bassoon and orchestra. It's just an amazing piece. So this is Richard Strauss, not Johann Strauss. So we call Richard Strauss the real Strauss, as opposed to Joe Strauss, who, you know, writes those pleasant little waltzes. There's a trio by Glinka, which I have played and is a very pretty piece. I played it with the now principal bassoonist of the Adelaide Symphony Orchestra. So you're going to absolutely adore these last two pieces. And then I'll call it a day because I've started recording from the first of my Renaissance recorder books. And I'll come back to you for an announcement of what I'm doing for my next live stream. You're going to love it. I've just discovered this singer whom I'm desperately in love with. He's just amazing. But I'll let you know what that's going to be after these tracks.
Thank you. Thank you.
cool. That's the end of the program today. Hopefully I can get my webcam to work. Glinka, Mikhail Glinka is a Russian, I think. I have an amazing program for the next live stream. Your Monday night, my Tuesday morning. I'm going to be presenting a piece that has enormous personal significance to me. And it's a piece that kind of got me through a lot of dark days in London. The story is that I was introduced to this piece, I think in about my first year at the conservatorium. I was preparing some what they call the fantasy Stücke, or fantasy pieces, by Robert Schumann for clarinet and piano. And my teacher said, "Well, if you want to be able to play the fantasy Stücke, you have to listen to Die Stille Liebe," which was also written by Schumann. So his reasoning was, if you want to find out the style of a composer, listen to his other stuff. And I started listening to Die Stille Liebe, and it was so beautiful, and then it just got so very, very dark, and I wanted to slit my wrists. So it's an amazing work. I was looking on YouTube for renditions of Die Stille Liebe. Die Stille Liebe is a song cycle. The poems of the song cycle taken from Heinrich Heine, a German poet. I came across this. It's only about a half hour piece. But I came across this amazing singer, Jonas Kaufmann, incredible, incredible singer, and you'll see in this performance on Monday night how worked up he gets, because it starts quite beautifully and then gets dark in a hurry. And you can see the pain and feel the pain of this particular singer. I think he's I think Jonas Kaufmann's just the most amazing thing I've come across in a long time. And I've listened to a number of renditions of Die Stille Liebe. I thought my favorite was Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau, and I must say emotionally that Jonas Kaufmann leaves him in the dirt. And what I'm going to play after this particular rendition of Die Stille Liebe is then you're going to hear my interpretation based on my knowledge of Die Stille Liebe of the Fantasy Stücke by Schumann. And I'm also going to treat you to a short little romance for clarinet, soprano, and piano, also by Schumann. And then I'm going to play you nothing to do with Schumann, but another taste of Jonas Kaufmann. I know that in my last live stream I made fun of Carmen via Spike Jonze. Well, this is going to be an aria in Carmen, for real, sung by Jonas Kaufmann, and it's one of the most confronting performances of this particular aria I've ever encountered. This guy is just amazing. It's after midday here, Saturday morning. I've got 6 hours of football coming up, and then the Test cricket from England. So I'm going to have to love you and leave you. So be sure to tune in Monday night when I present Schumann's Die Stille, performed by the absolutely incredible Jonas Kaufmann, and then how that performance of Die Stille influenced my own interpretation of Schumann's Fantasiestücke. So going to leave you there. I think we've had some amazing music, and it was so nice to chat to Sean. He's one of the nicest, most generous people I know. My mother-in-law absolutely adores him. And then I've got a special guest next weekend, another Baroque specialist, a trumpeter, although it will actually be a Thursday night, not Friday night, because he's only available on a Friday morning. I've known this fellow since my mid-teens. That's John Foster, and so we have quite a history. We've toured together, I'll leave you fine people to get on with your Friday night. I've certainly enjoyed presenting this program, and I think I'm going to have to present an entire program on Richard Strauss. He's just an amazing composer. So on the weekends I will try to have a special guest. I know lots of interesting people, and musicians are generally interesting people. Yes, it will be at 5 p.m. I'm going to leave it there. It's always hard signing off. I'll see you guys on Monday night or Tuesday morning, my time, for Die Stille. All right.